Welcome to A Work in Progress, a virtual worship experience at Myers Park Presbyterian Church. I hope that in the minutes ahead, you'll experience something of the love and grace of God in Jesus Christ. So I invite you to join us and open yourself to that experience in worship.
We call it the Council at Dunkin' Donuts. It was a night in graduate school where we got together with a group of friends. It happened to be Mardi Gras, and so we were sharing that last donut before Lent. And we were talking about people at school, people we didn't know very well, people who annoyed us, made us tired. And we realized that we were entering into a season of Lent as a community of people living together. And so that council at Dunkin' Donuts made a commitment to participate in the action of taking on friendship, working at loving one another, because we knew that was Christ's command to us. It was a significant event in my life because it helped me realize that friendship takes work, that loving people is not just something that happens, that we have to respond in life, listen, and be present with one another. Jesus' command is to love one another. It's not a suggestion. It's not just something that's a casual thing that Jesus said to his disciples. It's a commandment. Love one another. And so may we love each other, not just by imitating Christ, but may we love each other as a manifestation of God's love. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for your love that is unconditional, that reaches out to us regardless of who we are and what we do. And so may we respond out of love to one another. Give us your eyes to see each other. Help us to love as you love, and participate in the love that you are offering to all those around us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
This week we continue in our Lenten series about friendship, listening to Jesus as he talks to the disciples gathered for the Last Supper. We call this long talk the farewell discourse. He's preparing the disciples for what life will be like when he's gone and trying to prepare them for how they can live faithfully together. In today's passage, we come right after he has identified Judas as the one who will betray him by feeding Judas a piece of bread and then sending Judas off to do what he's called to do. So let's listen together now. We're in John chapter 13, starting at verse 31. When Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus answered, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow afterward." Peter said to him, "Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you." Jesus answered, "Will you lay down your life for me? Very truly, I tell you, before the cock crows, you will have denied me three times." So Jesus tells them he's giving them a new commandment to love one another. It's not really new, is it? I mean, back in the Old Testament, they were told to love their neighbors, to love those around them. So is it new to love one another? what about this might be new? And I wonder, is it because Jesus said, just as I love you, so you also should love one another? Is it that now we have a role model of love, an incarnated, embodied love in Jesus of Nazareth, that when we look to him, we see what it means to love our neighbors and to love one another? And when I think about that, my first instinct is to say, that's not realistic. I can't love like Jesus loved. If that's the standard, then I already feel like a failure, because I think of Jesus as fully God, and God loves perfectly, and there's no way I'll ever be able to do that. And yet, I also remember that Jesus was fully human, and he had limitations like I have. So he had to rest, and he had to eat, and we see in Scripture times when he had to step away and pray and spend time by himself. So as a human being, Jesus showed incredible love for his friends and for all those around him, people who needed his care. So maybe Jesus is the role model for loving one another and loving our friends. He goes on to talk to Peter, and Peter talks about laying down his life for him. We've already heard in this gospel, Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. We know that in just a few chapters in the gospel, Jesus will lay down his life. It's willingly sacrificing himself for those he loves. I wonder how we live out that call to love one another by laying down our lives for each other. And there's some ways about that that can be really unhealthy, totally giving up on ourselves and just giving in to somebody else and what they seem to want. I don't think that's what Jesus means here. When he talks about laying down your life, I wonder if what he means is letting go of some of your way of doing things in order to love someone else. Loving them the way they need to receive love rather than the way you want it to be. I wonder if part of what he means here is making space in your life to love somebody else. There are times in my life when life is so full of just busy things and scheduling that I don't really have time to pay attention to people the way I think Jesus calls me to do it. I don't have the time to show love for a friend because I'm being too busy. Many, many years ago at Princeton Seminary, they did this little experiment where they gave seminary students a scripture passage and they had to prepare a sermon about it. And they gave them all the same scripture. It was the story of the Good Samaritan. You might remember it, where Jesus told the story about the man who was beaten by robbers and left in the ditch, and a Levite comes by, a priest comes by, good people come by, and they don't help the man in the ditch. And then the unexpected one, the Samaritan, helps him. Well, then what they did to these students, they told them, you're going to preach this sermon to be evaluated in another building across campus. And half of the students were told, oh, you're running late. You better hurry. And the other half were told, oh, you've got lots of time. Take your time. You've got a long time before you have to be there, but go across campus. Between their leaving place and their destination, they had an actor playing the part of the man in the ditch, somebody laying there on the side of the road who looked a little homeless and looked like maybe they'd been injured. And they found that all these seminary students, people preparing to go into ministry, who had been working on this scripture about the Good Samaritan, the ones who thought they were running late to make it to the room didn't stop. But the ones who thought they had extra time stopped. So I wonder what our perception of our time means for the way we love each other. When we don't think we have time, it's really hard to be loving. But if we give ourselves the room, the time, we find that we're able to love each other. That might mean fewer commitments on the calendar. It might mean actually putting on the calendar, love my friends, whether that's a phone call or writing a note or something else, going on a walk together or meeting for a cup of coffee. Maybe that's part of what Jesus meant by laying down our life for one another, being willing to stop and love. I also wonder, because he started in this section talking about glory. He said, the Son of Man's been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. God has been glorified in him. God will glorify him in himself. And I wonder if we see God's glory when we're loving one another. Have you ever seen someone who they've been doing something? Maybe it was tutoring a child at Billingsville Cotswold, or maybe it was on a mission trip to El Salvador, or something like that. And when they came and talked about that experience, it was as if they were glowing with excitement. What if that's the glory of God that shines out from us when we love one another? The glory of God that can shine just literally makes our faces shine with excitement and love. So, love one another. I give you this new commandment. Go and love one another just as I have loved you. It's the way God's glory will shine in the world. It's the way we'll slow down to take care of each other. And it's the way that we'll be faithful to following Jesus Christ, the one who is fully God and fully human. Let's join him in loving our friends. Loving our friends because the world will see us. And that's how they know we are his followers, when we love one another. Amen.
If you ever find yourself stuck in the middle of the sea, I'll sail the world to find you. And if you ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. We'll find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me like 1, 2, 3, and I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2, and you'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, yeah. Ooh, ooh, yeah, yeah. If you're tossing and you're turning and you just can't fall asleep, I'll sing a song beside you. And if you ever forget how much you really mean to me, every day I will remind you. We'll find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me like 1, 2, 3, and I'll be there. And I know when I need it, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2, and you'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, yeah.
Join with me in prayer. Holy God, we hold on to the words of Scripture. They are living words, and they are words that draw us into new life in Christ. Today, the living word of Scripture calls us to remember, just as I have loved you, to remember that great love of Jesus as we first experienced it in our lives and in our hearts. Lord, help us to pause in this moment to remember the first time we felt that love. Did we experience it through Scripture? Did we experience it through a small group of a church? Did we experience through a wise mentor, a friend in the faith? Did we experience it in Sunday school, through one of our Sunday school teachers? Did we experience it through the care of a pastor or a deacon? Holy God, help us to remember the palpable and transformative feeling of that love that changed us, that called us into new ways of life, that helped us imagine new ways of being human. Lord, for that love, for that sense of agape love, we give you thanks and praise, for it matters to us. It makes us better human beings. Help us to live into the call of that love, to pass on in a domino effect kind of way, that just as I have loved you. May I do that for my children. May I do that for the children entrusted to us in the life of this congregation and church. May we do that for the children of our neighbors here in Charlotte, new Afghan refugees in the Charlotte-Mecklenburg school system, perhaps in the days to come, Ukrainian children arriving. Lord, may we share that agape love of Christ in big and transformative ways. May we linger. May we build time into our busy schedules to stay put and to be still and to listen so that we can show up with love, so that we can show up with that big heart of Christ, that transformative way of being present to each and every prayer before us. Lord, as we linger in this text today, help us to remember the new commandment to love one another. May we do that boldly. May we do that emboldened by you and by your power working through us. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Jesus told us to love one another. Just as he has loved us, we're called to love one another. So, my friends, this week, find a way to love your friends. Open up some time for them. Pay attention to them. And know that God is with you and the glory of God will shine through you when you're sharing that love. Go in peace. Amen.
And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never ends.